Hello, thanks for joining us for All the World's a Stage. One institution which has affected mankind more than any other is undoubtedly the Church, which had a say in just about everything. Remember the Holy Roman Empire? Well, the theatre was also profoundly influenced by the Church, both directly and indirectly, as you'll see in tonight's episode, when Ronald Harwood explores ancient pagan rituals, religion in general, and then draws a parallel between them and how they affected and influenced drama. Fascinating. Here it is.
And as they did eat, Jesus took bread, and blessed, and brake it, and gave to them, and said, Take, eat, this is my body. And he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, and they all drank of it. And he said unto them, This is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for many. Verily I say unto you, I will drink no more of the fruit of the vine until that day that I drink it new in the kingdom of God.
The words of Jesus, which initiated the central sacrament of Christian belief, the act of Holy Communion. And what, you may rightly ask, does the most sacred of the Church's offices have to do with the history of the theatre? What does that mystery, here depicted by Leonardo, have to do with this? The answer is that there's a powerful and compelling connection. The Christian faith made possible a new birth, a new theatre. The history of the drama is now concerned with the world, the European world, around 500 AD. We are in that period, called for convenience, the Dark Ages. The Roman Empire has crumbled, and with it, what vestiges of official, organized theatrical life it had to offer. There is no major playwright at work. The theater, the drama throughout Europe, is apparently dead, or at best, in a state of suspended animation. The early Christian Church crushed the art of the drama, and since it was the victors who wrote the history, evidence of any living theatrical tradition is hard to come by. But there was, I believe, an unrecorded and important link to pagan Rome somehow maintained, as we shall see. But what matters now is that the Church has set its face sternly against the theatre. And no wonder, Imperial Rome had misused the theatre as a propaganda instrument against the early Church. And more frighteningly, it had made a public spectacle of Christian persecution. Added to which, the early Christians believed that because the Roman theatre was lewd and obscene, all theatre was lewd and obscene. Its power, apparently, threatened to undermine the new moral order. But if, as I believe, the drama is needed, then it can't simply have vanished off the face of the earth. Theatre or no theatre, the drama is still necessary. And so it was in the Dark Ages that the drama was kept alive at first unwittingly by the Church itself, by its need to demonstrate the mystery of Holy Communion. Celebrants and congregation are about to share in the mystery of what St. Gregory called the one thing made visible and invisible. The Mass itself can be interpreted as an elaborate drama with definite roles assigned to the participants and even a plot. The Mass is ritual drama, and there are certain fascinating parallels with Greek tragedy: a fall from grace, suffering, the renewal of life. Christ may even be viewed as a tragic hero in whom the congregation, the people, places its faith. The priest consecrates the bread and the wine, and they become the body and blood of Jesus Christ. The priest performs a mysterious and magical function. Matter is changed. Faith in a mystery, in the irrational. The supplicants, by taking into their mouths the consecrated wafer, now in their belief the body of Christ, are in communion with their God. In so doing, they are forging links with rituals from a pagan past. The Christian communion is an act in the theater of worship. It is an act which requires absolute faith. In the Dark Ages, Europe was Christian. Latin was the official language of the church and the educated, but the great mass of people were illiterate. The story of Christ had to be made available and intelligible to them. Symbolic figures were created, which were instantly recognizable, and which made the life and passion of Christ apparent and vivid. An unknown author in 1493 wrote that these images served three things.
For they be ordained to stir man's mind to think on Christ's incarnation, and on his passion, and on his living, and on other saints' living. Also they be ordained to stir man's affection and his heart to devotion, for often man is more stirred by sight than by hearing or reading. Also they be ordained to be a token and a book to the lewd people.
The drama and symbolism of the church was now to be midwife to the new secular drama that was yet to be born, and the cradle was to be the pagan, the pre-Christian past. The church, in those first centuries after Christ's birth, understood that the pre-Christian past had to be used. But how? Well, here's an example, the ruined chapel of St. Pancras, Canterbury. Legend has it that this was once a pre-Christian burial ground where the Kentish tribes gathered in sacred rites. Now, it's always puzzled me why so many Christian churches are built on sites that had once been used for pagan worship. It is, I discover, no accident, but a deliberate, rational policy clearly expressed by a pope, Gregory the Great. In 601, he instructed St. Augustine at Canterbury not to destroy pagan temples. He had greater vision than that.
Destroy the idols, purify the buildings with holy water, set relics there, and let them become the temples of the true God. Have no need to change their places of concourse. And where of old they were wont to sacrifice cattle to demons, thither let them continue to resort on the day of the saint to whom the church is dedicated, and slay their beasts no longer as a sacrifice, but for a social meal in honor of him whom they now worship. Thank you.
Not only were the pagan sites to be used, but also pagan celebrations. The marriage of the Christian and pagan calendars now becomes important. The festivals of Christianity, like the festivals of ancient Greece and Rome, were to be essential to the development of the new theatre. Spring, the time to celebrate the death of winter, the return of summer, the season of renewal, rebirth, resurrection. These are the mummers of Abbots Bromley in the heart of England, and they are performing the horn dance, a sort of play that predates Christianity. Here, with antlers thought to be over 1,000 years old, the mummers impersonate beings other than themselves. And although, for unexplained reasons, this event no longer takes place in spring, it is similar to plays which were performed all over Europe. And all the plays contained one central element, the resurrection of life. English Christians called their spring festival after its Anglo-Saxon goddess, Eostre. Easter, the festival which proclaims perhaps the most important Christian mystery, Christ's rising from the dead. But the priests face the problem that the resurrection, unlike the consecration of the host, cannot be shown, cannot be demonstrated. Yet, apparently they sensed from their own experience that to dramatize an event was to imprint it indelibly on man's consciousness. They began to make it into a play. Quem quaeritis, whom do you seek in the tomb, O lovers of Christ? Asks a priest impersonating an angel. Jesus of Nazareth, he that was crucified, O heavenly one, reply other priests dressed as the three women who visit Christ's tomb. He is not here. He has risen as he had prophesied. Go announce that he has risen from the dead. Thus, in the 10th century, the priests began to don the costumes of the women and the angels at the tomb of the resurrection. And around the empty tomb, which became the center of the drama, they reenacted the story in plain chant. And this ritual, the Quem Quaeritis, proved effective and compelling, so much so that today we have over 400 different versions from monasteries all over Europe. And in some examples, the three women went to buy spice before visiting the empty tomb. The spice merchant, a sort of pagan quack doctor, a figure borrowed from the mumming plays, would indulge in comic asides with his wife and assistant. And these additions are important because they introduced the human element, the profane, side by side with the sacred, part of an impulse to embrace all human experience. That need to embrace all human experience was powerfully felt by medieval man. He needed, it seems, to be able to contain his world in order to comprehend it, to fit within a frame all he knew and understood. The cathedrals he built symbolize that impulse. As a testament to the glory of God, they stand as assertions of goodness, of life. But they also embraced images of death, evil, the horrible and the grotesque, because man's faith in God's universe was unshakable. Man had little sense of history. The historical, in his terms, the biblical past, was one with the present. So episodes from Christ's life were translated into medieval European images. Herod, a ducal tyrant. Noah, a shipwright of the North Sea ports. The shepherds, like those to be seen on the fells of Yorkshire, the hillsides of France or Germany. It was imagery which would inevitably find its way into their theatre. The resurrection was one great event in the Christian calendar. The Nativity was the other. And since the dramatization of the Easter mystery had proved so effective, it was little wonder that the Nativity would come in for similar treatment. But it was this figure, the figure of Herod, which was to provide the church with a dilemma. Herod was evil. And the problem was, should evil be perpetrated in the house of God? Furthermore, was it right that a priest should impersonate such a figure? Was it blasphemy? And what happens now seems to me both human and theatrical. The character of Herod takes over the Nativity plays. The villain proves irresistible. But how to dramatize evil? The question is asked really for the first time. The church fathers were concerned with the problems within the drama of blasphemy and immorality. There had been one previous and rather touching attempt to come to terms with the problem of immorality and evil in the drama, but it remained private and confined. Because the church had chosen Latin as the language of worship, the Latin of pagan and immoral Rome had to be studied in monasteries and convents. In the 10th century, in Saxony, a nun called Hirosvita wrote 6 plays modelled on the comedies of Terence, whom she had read and admired. Her approach to her task illustrates well the prevailing mood of the time. She wrote a preface which outlined her dilemma.
I, the strong voice of Gundersheim, have not hesitated to imitate in my writings the poet Terence, whose works are so widely read. My object being to glorify, within the limits of my poor talents, the laudable chastity of Christian virgins in that selfsame style of composition that has been used to describe the shameless acts of licentious women. One thing has, all the same, embarrassed me and often brought a blush to my cheek. It is that I have been compelled, through the nature of this work, to apply my mind and my pen to depicting the dreadful frenzy of those possessed by unlawful love and the insidious sweetness of passion. Things that should not even be named amongst us. Yet if from modesty I had refrained from treating these subjects, I should not then have obtained my object, to glorify the innocent to the best of my ability. I have no doubt that many will say that my poor work is much inferior to that of the author whom I have taken as my model, that it is of a much humbler scale and altogether different. In the humbler works of my salad days, I gathered up my poor researches into heroic strophes, but here I have sifted them into a series of dramatic scenes and avoided through omission the pernicious voluptuousness of pagan writers.
Hirosvita's plays were never performed. To the church fathers, the problem remained. The drama was undoubtedly effective, but it was dangerous to the moral order. There were to be various solutions. An evil character could be played by a layman rather than a priest. But would the layman risk everlasting damnation by portraying wickedness? To this day, in Oberammergau, the actors in the famous Passion play receive a pardon before the performance, just in case. In a sense, in the church's eyes, the danger of dramatizing evil would never quite disappear. But then something happened which seemed unrelated to the problem, but which unwittingly helped to solve it. The church instituted a new feast day in the calendar. It was to celebrate Christ's humanity rather than his divinity, and it's still celebrated in some parts of Europe, as here in Poland. Until 1311, the Feast of the Sacrament had been celebrated on the eve of Good Friday, a period when the church's calendar was overcrowded and the mood sorrowful. The vital decision from our point of view then was the new date of the feast, summertime. It became a major holiday. It was to be called the Feast of Corpus Christi, And the important thing was that for the first time, the consecrated bread was to be carried ceremoniously out of the church into the sunlight. It brought together churchmen, the craft guilds, and the city elders, all of whom were accustomed to mounting processions in their own right. In some places, the processions became more elaborate. In time, although no one is certain when, tableaus on floats appeared, carrying participants who performed biblical scenes in dumb show. Eventually, they even exchanged snatches of dialogue, in the vernacular, not Latin. Out of such exchanges developed a highly popular drama, known as the play of Corpus Christi. So the stage was set. Religious festival, summertime, dumb shows and playlets, processions. Now even sin and wickedness could be portrayed because the celebrations took place outside the house of God, in the open air. And so evolved the mystery or miracle plays in celebration of man's salvation. In keeping with the familiar longing to embrace all human experience pell-mell, the mystery plays set out to display the entire history of the universe from creation to the end of the world. They were played on pageants or wagons, which were dragged through the streets. The details of how exactly they were performed are a scholastic battlefield. What can be said for certain is, the wagons carried a set built to represent a given background against which actors performed, and that the mystery plays were an expression of genuine street theatre. But obviously, a great many events had to be strung together, a cycle of short, dramatic pieces from the creation to the last judgment. And this, in a truncated version, is what we think one of those scenes would have looked like. The play is the harrowing of hell, thought to be one of the more spectacular items, and is set at the mouth of hell. It would have been full of formidable stage effects, possibly thunder, a lot of smoke, and certainly fireworks. The playlet is based on the apocryphal gospel of Nicodemus and tells how Jesus, between crucifixion and resurrection, descended into limbo, where he finds, of course, an assortment of devils, including Satan himself and Beelzebub. But more surprisingly, among others, Adam, Eve, and John the Baptist.
My brethren, hearken to me here. Such hope of health we never had. 4,600 years have we been held here in this stead. Now see I sign of solace clear. A glorious gleam to make us glad. Wherefore, I hope our health is near, and soon shall cease our sorrows sad.
Adam, my husband free. This means solace attain. Such light shall on us be, in paradise full plain.
As voice crying, I told all lands the ways of Christ as well I can. I baptized him with both my hands, even in the flood of flowing Jordan. The Holy Ghost did from heaven descend as a white dove down on him then. The Father's voice, my mirth to mend, was made to me, even as man. This is my son, he said, in whom I am pleased full well. His light is on us laid. He comes our cares to heal.
Help Beelzebub to bind these boys. Such harrow was never heard in hell. I roar in revival.
For baby time. Say!
What? Hearest thou not this ugly noise? These lurdens that in limbo dwell, they make meaning of many joys, and muster them great mirth to tell.
Mirth? Mirth? Nay, nay, that point is past. More help shall they not have.
They cry on Christ full fast, and say he shall them save.
Atolite portas principes, open up! Ye princes of pain severe, et elevamini eternales, your endless gates that ye have here.
Hark, Beelzebub, I have great dread, for hideously I heard him call.
Ho! Bar thy gates, ill mightals be, and set forth watches on the wall! And if he call or cry, to make us more debate, lay on him then hardly, and make him gang his gait!
Tell me what boy dare be so bold to make such disarray?
It is the Jew that Judas sold to die the death the other day.
Out! Out! This taking time is told. This traitor crosses us alway. Here shall he be full hard to hold. Look that he pass not, I thee pray.
Principes, porta tollite! Undo your gates, ye princes of pride! Et introivit rex gloriae! The king of bliss comes in this tide!
Jesus, with the help of the archangel Michael and his resonant sword, confronts Satan and his cohorts and frees the tormented souls.
Out, out, O Harrow! What harlot here is he that says his kingdom shall be cried?
This stead shall stand no more by token. Open up and let my people pass.
Out! Behold! All our paling is broken, and burst are all our bands of brass. Tell Lucifer, all is unlocking.
What then? Is limbo law, alas? Make Satan help! We are for Satan!
This work is worse than ever it was.
I bade he should be bound if he made masteries more. Go strike him to the ground and set him sad and sore.
Is soon said, but come thyself and serve him so. We may not bite his bitter blow. He will us more, even were we mow.
What faint hearts? Wherefore are you feared? Have you no force to flit him fro? See quick that all my gear's prepared. Myself shall to that gadlin go. Now, Bellamy, abide, and with thy boastful cheer, tell to me this tide, what masteries make you here?
I make no masteries but for mine. Them shall I save, I say again.
Sayest thou all shall gang, or shall some alway with us dwell?
All that list not to learn my lore, that I have left in lands now new, unto my doom I shall them draw, and judge them worse than any few.
Now here is my hand. I hold me glad. This plan will pain our profit save. If this be sooth that thou hast said, we shall have more than now we have.
Michael, my angel, hither soon. Fasten yon fiend that he not flit. And devil, I command thee, go down into thy cell where thou shalt sit.
Out, Sir Harrow! Now help my hand! Wax I woe out of my wits. Alas for dole and care, I sink into hell pits.
Ah, Jesus, Lord, fickle is thy mind.
That play comes from the north of England, from the cathedral city of York, where it was performed by the Guild of Saddlers. The citizens of York, like those of Chester and Wakefield, and cities all over Europe, brought their own special feeling and imagination to the performances. In York, the pomp and colour of the Corpus Christi processions gave rise to a splendid sequence of plays which are of special importance. Because to this very day, that cycle is still performed at 4 yearly intervals by the people of York. The key to York's success in the Middle Ages lay in its guilds, associations of artisans and traders who were the secular organizers of the city. Each guild would undertake to mount one playlet in the sequence. Today, the huge cast of the York Mystery Players is drawn from all walks of life. Amateurs, who give their time and energy to the presentation of this age-old tradition. As in the past, there are only two professionals. The actor who plays Jesus, in this case, Christopher Timothy, and the director for the 1980 production, Patrick Garland.
May I ask of you to stand up, would you, when I call out your name, and when I ask what parts you're playing, to say them in a fairly loud and clear voice. Betty Doig, Mrs. Doig.
Martha.
Good, strong voice. You've done it several times, haven't you?
I've been in the crowd once, and I played Mary the Mother the last time.
That's right. And are your family in it, too?
Husband crowd, Angela crowd, John, props and stage management, and Andrew Lyon.
There are several people in the play, I mean, really quite a quantity, who've been in many of them before, and they bring all this to each rehearsal, and it's very moving for me. They often correct me, not because they're trying to say, and they don't, they say, you know, we don't want to interfere, but last time we did this. Mm. But it's a tradition that I delight in because it often is right. It seems to relate to a popular feeling, a popular memory that is ancient.
Nigel Ashworth.
Disciple 2 and Thief on the Right.
I know that in the original productions, that the good people were paid much more than the bad people.
The sets in the Middle Ages were elaborate and costly. They were built onto the flat wagons called pageants, like the one we saw earlier. Today, the plays are staged in the ruins of a nearby abbey. But if the setting is simpler, the production is no less elaborate. Now, as then, gunpowder and squibs are used, and thunder sheets and earthquake barrels, animals and children.
Can I have the little devils, please? Can they all come? The devils who run around.
And we know that in former times, actors would run out among the audience. Today, audience participation is no less important.
Can Julia's little girls be devils, David? I'd like them to be devils. Good. Right, now I tell you what you're doing. You scuttle, when it's all wheeled on, you all hide yourself under the wheels, but not during it, because you'd get crushed.
And with this play, this production, I think for me the key will be the crowd. They give me an enormous charge. It's a force that I'm not used to dealing with. It's wonderful to have the privilege of working with 200 people. There's a tremendous unselfishness, which is joyful. My experience as a professional director is you always have to explain to professional actors that whatever contribution they're making, it's very important, and one means it sincerely, and that it isn't just involved in the general mass. Here, it's the reverse. They want to be in the crowd. They ask, they audition, they advertise, can we be in the crowd? Because we were in it last time and the time before, and a lot of them have done four or five of them.
And this is where you begin to unwrap the sandwiches and the things you've got.
They love coming to rehearsal. They turn up sometimes on cold and grey days, even when it's raining, and they faithfully stand there. And one elderly lady who had auditioned to play a speaking part for the first time, she'd been in several of the other plays at 4 yearly intervals, and on this occasion she said, I would like a part, but I don't suppose I'll get one, but if I don't get a speaking part, and I very much doubt that I will, but that wouldn't matter, but if I were to get a speaking part, I'd not lose crowd work, would I? I do love the crowd. Mm. And I found this very, very touching and very typical.
This was the moment in history when the theatre once more became part of people's lives, when the drama re-entered man's consciousness. Whole cities were turned into theatres. Now, as I said, arguments rage over the exact nature of presentation of the plays in the Middle Ages, but the sequence must have taken the best part of a day to perform. Audiences were summoned well before dawn to the corners and squares of the city where the wagons would pause and the plays would be enacted. The size of the operation may seem to us unwieldy, but the plays, because of the breadth of their scope, because of the involvement of so many, have the power to touch us deeply by their faith.
Forsooth, son, to thee shall I say, with me shalt thou dwell now this day in paradise, heaven's high hall. My God! My God! Oh, why? Lama Sabatani! Hast thou forsaken me? In
the great cycle plays, the mystery plays, were not only to be found in the north of England. Far from it. The explosion of drama in the Middle Ages differs from others in at least one important respect. It was not confined to a single country. France, Italy, Germany, Spain, all had their own versions of the mystery plays. And the city as theatre was not the only method of presentation. Because here in Cornwall, in southwest England, there's an interesting piece of evidence. And it's connected with a local saint, St. Piran. The evidence lies here under gorse and bush, largely forgotten. Legend has it that St. Piran preached here, and it's from him it takes its name, the Piran Round. It's where the Cornish used regularly to perform their own mystery cycle, and where occasional revivals still take place. We can also deduce that medieval theatre came to be performed in the Round from the manuscript of a play which has production notes attached, and a stage plan for performance. The piece is called The Castle of Perseverance, and we now describe it as a morality play, dating from about 1425. The morality play is a kind of dramatized sermon, but by that I don't mean to suggest the yawning dullness of a modern pulpit. The morality play was intended, obviously, to make a moral point, but it was also meant to be entertaining. A lonely hero, like a lost soul, wanders through a timeless landscape and is accosted by personifications of vice, virtue, evil, repentance, wisdom, folly. And in spite of their sermonizing, these plays are the first halting steps towards genuine psychological drama. By using dialogue, a dramatic dialogue between the characters, the hero's feelings are examined and analyzed. The hero is a generalized figure, and so he becomes a representation for all of us, for mankind. He becomes every man, afraid of death, of everlasting damnation. And he's a figure who, in other morality plays, is victimized by his own vices. His moral welfare is the castle upon which those vices, sometimes comic, sometimes sinister, make their assaults.
As I said at the beginning, the church wrote the history of the period, and so the evidence for religious drama abounds. But I believe that a vagrant, secular theater, quite independent from the church, and reaching back to pagan Rome, must have been living rough for 1,000 years. Dramatic entertainment is a perennial need. It must have survived, perhaps in its crudest form, in the streets of Europe or anywhere else a crowd could be collected. Acrobats, minstrels, jongleurs, troubadours would have traveled from town to town, providing what may be described as street circus. No one can say for certain how much of that older tradition was preserved in folk memory by mime artists or by some other unrecorded tradition of performance. Certainly, it's very difficult to believe that acting simply disappeared in Europe and that the church started it again from scratch. But I believe there is evidence of that older tradition. That variety of professional theatre known as commedia dell'arte. The tradition of travelling European players can be most clearly identified in Italy in the early 16th century. It surfaced with uninhibited gusto and it bore some startling resemblances to the theatre of ancient Rome, especially the theatre of Plautus. One such troupe still performs today. They've devoted their lives to the commedia, playing in and around Venice. They're called the Cooperativa Autori. Commedia actors combine the skills of dancer, singer, acrobat, low comedian, and pantomimist. They had to be able to sing or play a musical instrument. They had to be able to improvise with wit and speed along an agreed storyline, and within the limits of the gallery of stock characters which made the form so popular. Strong echoes there of Plautus. And although there is no absolute proof of an unbroken tradition to the Roman playwright, Commedia and Plautus have a great deal in common. The masks are similar, the plots identical. Generally amorous intrigues with a vein of low farce and also of tear-jerking sentiment.
Delle maschere della commedia dell'arte. E adesso...
But it's the stock characters which, I believe, clinch the argument. They're pure Plautus. Pantalone, the miserly merchant and candidate cuckold. Zani, the comic servant. Scaramucci or Scaramouche, the dashing soldier. Pulcinella, the hook-nosed hunchback. Instantly recognizable, as familiar as characters in a modern television soap opera. Here is an example of their style. Hungry as usual, the hard-done-by servant Zani, whose name incidentally gave us the word zany, catches and eats a fly. Troops travelled, the players would break the monotony of the journey by passing on to the younger members the songs, the gags, the monologues and tricks that were to be their stock in trade. Much of the tradition of commedia is lost to us because so little of it was ever written down. For 200 years, commedia's vitality and gaiety infected many of the nations of Europe.
The style was to be drawn upon by Molière in 17th century France and by Goldoni in 18th century Italy. And over this time, Commedia's appeal became more sophisticated, more refined, and they began to play in permanent theatres. Once Commedia had been absorbed by the higher echelons of society, Zani, for example, developed into two characters, Brighella and the familiar figure of Arlecchino, Harlequin. The artistry was to become quite dazzling. The Cooperativa Autori gives us a glimpse of it in this extract. Arlecchino, still the hard-done by servant, has to serve a meal for two different masters at the same time.
Arlecchino!
Un altro po' consigne, venio!
Che buona! Oh, 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 che buona!
Arlecchino? Ma insomma, vieni a servirmi!
Sì, e venio! Arrava! Venio a servirmi!
Arlecchino!
Arlecchino! Arlecchino! Arlecchino!
Eventually, there would come a point when the mask would be removed completely. As before in this history, the personality of the actor wanted to be recognized and acknowledged. And although the removal of the mask may be regarded as part of the humanizing process, it also signals the Commedia dell'arte's decline. The Cooperativa Autori shows us this through another familiar figure. It is she who exhorts Arlecchino to put away his mask and to become an ordinary actor. Her name is Columbina.
Leva questo volto nero di carbone. Vedi? E sei un uomo ora. Mettiti questo tricorno. E questo mantello. Puoi venire con me. Vieni.
Sì. Paesano, dove va sto?
Arlecchino, dove vai? Resta.
Dove vai? Arlecchino.
Arlecchino, resta qui.
Arlecchino, ma cosa ti fa?
Compare mio de Bergamo. Patron. Un po' si pi. Credeme.
Arlecchino, fratello mio di Bergamo, non andare!
Arlecchino!
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 Arlecchino.
The Commedia troops are important because they travelled all over Europe, influencing the theatre of many countries. It's even been suggested that they visited England. But of course, by the middle of the 16th century, the religion which underpinned the medieval English theatre was no longer common ground. In 1533, the English Church broke with Rome and became, in effect, a spiritual department of state, ruled by the King, Henry VIII, as God's deputy on earth. Catholic doctrines, as embodied in the mystery and morality plays, were questioned, censored, and finally suppressed. In 1576, the Diocesan Court of High Commission for York commanded that the mystery play performed at Corpus Christi in Wakefield was to be banned. No pageants, no counterfeiting the Lord's Supper. The Protestants were attacking Catholic superstition and idolatry. But there's a wonderful and rare chronological symmetry to this story. In that same year, 1576, a carpenter turned actor called James Burbage combined his two skills and set off for London intending to build a theatre. I like to think he was somehow influenced by that largely forgotten circle in Cornwall. In London, Burbage called his playhouse the theatre. It was built in a circular shape, the shape of the Greek theatres and of their Roman imitators, the shape of St. Pyrrhon's Round, and of that staging plan for the Castle of Perseverance. A wooden O.
We'll see Jeremy Irons and Paul Rogers in both rehearsal and performance of scenes from Hamlet as we arrive at the sophisticated theatre of Shakespeare's time. By the close of the 16th century, with permanent theatres built in London, 15,000 people were attending the theatre each week. All the World's a Stage on SBS TV next Sunday at 8:30. Now stay watching for an unusual drama from Belgium coming up in International Playhouse.
Thanks for joining us for All the World's a Stage. One institution which has affected mankind more than any other is undoubtedly the Church, which had a say in just about everything. Remember the Holy Roman Empire. Well, the theatre was also profoundly influenced by the Church, both directly and indirectly, as you'll see in tonight's episode, when Ronald Harwood explores ancient pagan rituals, religion in general, and then draws a parallel between them and how they affected and influenced drama. Fascinating. Here it is.
Mm-hmm.
And as they did eat, Jesus took bread and blessed and broke it and gave to them and said, Take, eat, this is my body. And he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, and they all drank of it. And he said unto them, This is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for many. Verily I say unto you, I will drink no more of the fruit of the vine until that day that I drink it new in the kingdom of God.
The words of Jesus, which initiated the central sacrament of Christian belief, the act of Holy Communion. And what, you may rightly ask, does the most sacred of the church's offices have to do with the history of the theatre? What does that mystery, here depicted by Leonardo, have to do with this? The answer is that there's a powerful and compelling connection. The Christian faith made possible a new birth, a new theatre. The history of the drama is now concerned with the world, the European world, around 500 AD. We are in that period called for convenience the Dark Ages. The Roman Empire has crumbled, and with it, what vestiges of official, organized theatrical life it had to offer. There is no major playwright at work. The theater, the drama throughout Europe, is apparently dead, or at best, in a state of suspended animation. The early Christian church crushed the art of the drama, and since it was the victors who wrote the history, evidence of any living theatrical tradition is hard to come by. But there was, I believe, an unrecorded and important link to pagan Rome somehow maintained, as we shall see. But what matters now is that the church has set its face sternly against the theatre. And no wonder, Imperial Rome had misused the theatre as a propaganda instrument against the early church, and morphed the human element, the profane, side by side with the sacred, part of an impulse to embrace all human experience. That need to embrace all human experience was powerfully felt by medieval man. He needed, it seems, to be able to contain his world in order to comprehend it, to fit within a frame all he knew and understood. The cathedrals he built symbolized that impulse. As a testament to the glory of God, they stand as assertions of goodness, of life. But they also embraced images of death, evil, the horrible and the grotesque, because man's faith in God's universe was unshakable. Had little sense of history. The historical, in his terms, the biblical past, was one with the present. So episodes from Christ's life were translated into medieval European images. Herod, a ducal tyrant. Noah, a shipwright of the North Sea ports. The shepherds, like those to be seen on the fells of Yorkshire, the hillsides of France or Germany. It was imagery which would inevitably find its way into their theatre. The resurrection was one great event in the Christian calendar. The Nativity was the other. And since the dramatization of the Easter mystery had proved so effective, it was little wonder that the Nativity would come in for similar treatment. But it was this figure, the figure of Herod, which was to provide the church with a dilemma. Herod was evil. And the problem was, should evil be perpetrated in the house of God? Furthermore, was it right that a priest should impersonate such a figure? Was it blasphemy? And what happens now seems to me both human and theatrical. The character of Herod takes over the nativity plays. The villain proves irresistible. But how to dramatize evil? The question is asked really for the first time. The church fathers were concerned with the problems within the drama of blasphemy and immorality. There had been one previous and rather touching attempt to come to terms with the problem of immorality and evil in the drama, but it remained private and confined. Because the church had chosen Latin as the language of worship, the Latin of pagan and immoral Rome had to be studied in monasteries and convents. In the 10th century, in Saxony, a nun called Hirosvita wrote 6 plays modeled on the comedies of Terence, whom she had read and admired. Her approach to her task illustrates well the prevailing mood of the time. She wrote a preface which outlined her dilemma.
I, the strong voice of Gundersheim, have not hesitated to imitate in my writings the poet Terence, whose works are so widely read. My object being to glorify, within the limits of my poor talents, the laudable chastity of Christian virgins in that selfsame style of composition that has been used to describe the shameless acts of licentious women. One thing has, all the same, embarrassed me and often brought a blush to my cheek. It is that I have been compelled, through the nature of this work, to apply my mind and my pen to depicting the dreadful frenzy of those possessed by unlawful love. And the
frighteningly, it had made a public spectacle of Christian persecution. Added to which, the early Christians believed that because the Roman theatre was lewd and obscene, all theatre was lewd and obscene. Its power, apparently, threatened to undermine the new moral order. But if, as I believe, the drama is needed, then it can't simply have vanished off the face of the earth. Theatre or no theatre, the drama is still necessary. And so it was in the Dark Ages that the drama was kept alive at first unwittingly by the church itself, by its need to demonstrate the mystery of Holy Communion. Celebrants and congregation are about to share in the mystery of what St. Gregory called the one thing made visible and invisible. The Mass itself can be interpreted as an elaborate drama with definite roles assigned to the participants and even a plot. The Mass is ritual drama, and there are certain fascinating parallels with Greek tragedy: a fall from grace, suffering, the renewal of life. Christ may even be viewed as a tragic hero in whom the congregation, the people, places its faith. The priest consecrates the bread and the wine, and they become the body and blood of Jesus Christ. The priest performs a mysterious and magical function. Matter is changed. Faith in a mystery, in the irrational. The supplicants, by taking into their mouths the consecrated wafer, now in their belief the body of Christ, are in communion with their God. In so doing, they are forging links with rituals from a pagan past. The Christian communion is an act in the theatre of worship. It is an act which requires absolute faith. In the Dark Ages, Europe was Christian. Latin was the official language of the church and the educated, but the great mass of people were illiterate. The story of Christ had to be made available and intelligible to them. Symbolic figures were created, which were instantly recognizable, and which made the life and passion of Christ apparent and vivid. Thank you. An unknown author in 1493 wrote that these images served three things.
For they be ordained to stir man's mind to think on Christ's incarnation, and on his passion, and on his living, and on other saints' living. Also they be ordained to stir man's affection and his heart to devotion, for often man is more stirred by sight than by hearing or reading. Also they be ordained to be a token and a book to the lewd people.
The drama and symbolism of the church was now to be midwife to the new secular drama that was yet to be born, and the cradle was to be the pagan, the pre-Christian past. The church, in those first centuries after Christ's birth, understood that the pre-Christian past had to be used. But how? Well, here's an example, the ruined chapel of St. Pancras, Canterbury. Legend has it that this was once a pre-Christian burial ground where the Kentish tribes gathered in sacred rites. Now, it's always puzzled me why so many Christian churches are built on sites that had once been used for pagan worship. It is, I discover, no accident, but a deliberate, rational policy clearly expressed by a pope, Gregory the Great. In 601, he instructed St. Augustine at Canterbury not to destroy pagan...
Did your sweetness of passion... things that should not even be named amongst us. Yet if from modesty I had refrained from treating these subjects, I should not then have obtained my object, to glorify the innocent to the best of my ability. I have no doubt that many will say that my poor work is much inferior to that of the author whom I have taken as my model, that it is of a much humbler scale and altogether different. In the humbler works of my salad days, I gathered up my poor researches into heroic strophes, but here I have sifted them into a series of dramatic scenes and avoided through omission the pernicious voluptuousness of pagan writers.
Hirosvita's plays were never performed. To the church fathers, the problem remained. The drama was undoubtedly effective, but it was dangerous to the moral order. There were to be various solutions. An evil character could be played by a layman rather than a priest. But would the layman risk everlasting damnation by portraying wickedness? To this day, in Oberammergau, the actors in the famous Passion play receive a pardon before the performance, just in case. In a sense, in the church's eyes, the danger of dramatizing evil would never quite disappear. But then something happened which seemed unrelated to the problem, but which unwittingly helped to solve it. The church instituted a new feast day in the calendar. It was to celebrate Christ's humanity rather than his divinity, and it's still celebrated in some parts of Europe, as here in Poland. Until 1311, the Feast of the Sacrament had been celebrated on the eve of Good Friday, a period when the church's calendar was overcrowded and the mood sorrowful. The vital decision from our point of view then was the new date of the feast, summertime. It became a major holiday. It was to be called the Feast of Corpus Christi. And the important thing was that for the first time, the consecrated bread was to be carried ceremoniously out of the church into the sunlight. It brought together churchmen, the craft guilds, and the city elders, all of whom were accustomed to mounting processions in their own right. In some places, the processions became more elaborate. In time, although no one is certain when, tableaus on floats appeared, carrying participants who performed biblical scenes in dumb show. Eventually, they even exchanged snatches of dialogue, in the vernacular, not Latin. Out of such exchanges developed a highly popular drama, known as the play of Corpus Christi. So the stage was set. Religious festival, summertime, dumb shows and playlets, processions. Now even sin and wickedness could be portrayed because the celebrations took place outside the house of God, in the open air. And so evolved the mystery or miracle plays in celebration of man's salvation. In keeping with the familiar longing to embrace all human experience pell-mell, the mystery plays set out to display the entire history of the universe from creation to the end of the world. They were played on pageants or wagons, which were dragged through the streets. The details of how exactly they were performed are a scholastic battlefield. What can be said for certain is the wagons carried a set built to represent a given background against which actors performed, and that the mystery plays were an expression of genuine street theatre. But obviously, a great many events had to be strung together, a cycle of short, dramatic pieces from the creation to the last judgment. And this, in a truncated version, is what we think one of those scenes would have looked like. The play is the harrowing of hell, thought to be one of the more spectacular items, and is set at the mouth of hell. It would have been full of formidable stage effects, in temples. He had greater vision than that.
Destroy the idols, purify the buildings with holy water, set relics there, and let them become the temples of the true God. Have no need to change their places of concourse. And where of old they were wont to sacrifice cattle to demons, thither let them continue to resort on the day of the saint to whom the church is dedicated, and slay their beasts no longer as a sacrifice, but for a social meal in honor of him whom they now worship.
Were the pagan sites to be used, but also pagan celebrations. The marriage of the Christian and pagan calendars now becomes important. The festivals of Christianity, like the festivals of ancient Greece and Rome, were to be essential to the development of the new theatre. Spring, the time to celebrate the death of winter, the return of summer, the season of renewal, rebirth, resurrection. These are the mummers of Abbots Bromley in the heart of England, and they are performing the horn dance, a sort of play that predates Christianity. Here, with antlers thought to be over 1,000 years old, the mummers impersonate beings other than themselves. And although, for unexplained reasons, this event no longer takes place in spring, it is similar to plays which were performed all over Europe. And all the plays contained one central element, the resurrection of life. English Christians called their spring festival after its Anglo-Saxon goddess, Eostre. Easter, the festival which proclaims perhaps the most important Christian mystery, Christ's rising from the dead. But the priests face the problem that the resurrection, unlike the consecration of the host, cannot be shown, cannot be demonstrated. Yet, apparently they sensed from their own experience that to dramatize an event was to imprint it indelibly on man's consciousness. They began to make it into a play. Quem quaeritis, whom do you seek in the tomb, O lovers of Christ? Asks a priest impersonating an angel. Jesus of Nazareth, he that was crucified, O heavenly one, reply other priests dressed as the three women who visit Christ's tomb. He is not here. He has risen as he had prophesied. Go announce that he has risen from the dead. Thus, in the 10th century, the priests began to don the costumes of the women and the angels at the tomb of the resurrection. And around the empty tomb, which became the center of the drama, they reenacted the story in plain chant. And this ritual, the Quem Quiritus, proved effective and compelling. So much so that today we have over 400 different versions from monasteries all over Europe. And in some examples, the three women went to buy spice before visiting the empty tomb. The spice merchant, a sort of pagan quack doctor, a figure borrowed from the mumming plays, would indulge in comic asides with his wife and assistant. And these additions are important because they introduced